Welcome to the Seed Creative Podcast, the podcast where we discuss both video production and just life in general. The goal of this podcast is the same as the goal of our business, to make a difference in people's lives. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Seed Creative Podcast. My name is George Edmondson. I am your host today, along with my co-hosts, Jacob Cantrell and Adam Honeycutt. We are the kind of the three amigos, the three that kind of got Seed Creative fully going after I was decided to not be a freelance video guy and try to actually build some sort of a production company. So today we're going to be talking about our top five movies that could be top five favorite movies or top five movies that just inspire you, along with some honorable mentions that we might throw out there. But we're going to be discussing really anything. Why do you love that movie? Is it the cinematography, the story, the acting, the lighting, etc.? So I want to go first. Is that okay if I go first?
Absolutely.
Thank you, George, for your leadership.
Thank you, George, for your leadership.
That's right.
All right, so number five on my list, Secret Life of Walter Mitty. Have you seen that movie, Jacob?
No.
Dude, no! What about you?
Yes.
Okay. I've seen it once.
I've seen it once.
So you've seen it once?
Yeah.
Okay, so Secret Life of Walter Mitty is it's a film based on a book, and Ben Stiller is in it, but it... I don't know why I love the movie so much. It's kind of slow. It doesn't have the greatest reviews. But, dude, it just, the way it's shot is just, it's one of those movies that when I saw it, and I think that I saw it before I had gotten really in the video, I just could visually, I was like, something is different about this film. And it's, each shot sequence and the locations that are used and the framing is something that's really big in that movie. The framing is not what you would expect, but even the way that they frame a lot of shots in this movie are very intentional to the storytelling. There's one shot in particular I remember. Walter Mitty is he's framed and he's walking away from the city, and it's this super wide shot, and it's almost like it's a visual representation of how in the movie Walter Mitty daydreams a lot, and he like has to escape from reality. And so he's walking and he's framed right in this super wide shot. He's on this bridge and the city's behind him, but it's like he's not focused on the city. He's not focused on life. He's focused on like what it could be. And I think that that was like a really beautiful way to do that in the cinematography. But since freaking Jacob hadn't seen the movie and Adam's only seen it once, we can't really talk too much about it. So we're just going to go, around in a circle. So Jacob, what is your top five?
Am I starting at number five?
Yeah, start at number five.
Trying to think of the best way to do this would make it more interesting.
throw out things about it and see if we can guess it.
Okay, I think number five for me is gonna have to be a series of movies. It's a series of movies I grew up on.
RoboCop.
Yes, it's all the RoboCop movies. Are there more than one RoboCop?
Yes.
Okay.
And they get the PG-13 eventually. It's hilarious.
You actually want to guess? Or you want me to
throw out something?
A series of movies.
Yeah.
Harry Potter.
Lord of the Rings.
Wow, that was a good guess. That was it.
Really? That's great.
So Harry Potter is actually in my honorable mentions.
Beautiful.
So
you can help me talk about it, because I like movies.
Yeah.
And I like making videos, but I'm like much more the music guy. So I'm going to be like walking on crutches through this podcast. It's going to be great. I'm going to be like the butt of a lot of jokes.
Perfect. You already
are. It's
going
to be good. What?
So you already are the butt of a lot of jokes. Adam, so what are your thoughts on the Harry Potter films?
I think that there are millions and millions of people that would agree that they're amazing. I like some more than others. I tell you, though, when I saw the first one in the theater, I knew that they were special. Like, they really are good. They are. They do get progressively darker as they go along, but that kind of works because a lot of people grew up with them. So, like, you know, you start off seeing your first one when you're 10. By the time you're 15, it needs to be a little edgier to keep you, you know, going. I mean, that has more to do with J.K. Rowling than...
Sure, because the books do the same thing. Mm-hmm. And so that comes down to, like, just the story in general. And, of course, the cinematography is beautiful in a lot of them. But I fully agree with the fact that they are a lot brighter, a lot happier in the first films versus the final ones. And it is... is because people grow up with the movies, but it's also, in my opinion, that's life in general. Wouldn't you agree? When you're young, you're stupid, and everything is wonderful and great, and you don't realize how absolutely terrible the world can be. But then at the end, you know, there's always the light, and there's always the good, and there's always the positive. So why is it that you love those movies so much? Like, what's the one or two specific things about it?
I don't really have a good way to put it other than it's just like I grew up like as they were coming out.
Yeah.
So like I remember, I have a lot of memories associated to them. Like the first movie, I don't even think I was supposed to go see it, and my aunt took me to go see it when my parents didn't know.
They're gonna listen to this and get mad at your aunt.
They are. Well, they know all about it now, because after that, my mom bought me the like the box set of the first four books.
Oh, cool.
And I just like flew through them.
Yeah. So you read? Did you read all the books?
I did. So I have a confession. I never actually finished the seventh one.
Wow.
I know. I think I couldn't bring myself to do it because it was like so like close to home and like important to me that I just didn't want it to end. Because right, I cried so, like a baby at so, the end so, of the movies.
So what are your thoughts on Fantastic Beasts and stuff like that?
I haven't actually seen that.
I haven't
see,
either.
I've been out of the movie. I haven't really been like watching that many movies the past several years.
Yeah.
I've just been working a ton. And you've been telling me to like, oh, you need to stop and watch movies. It'll help you.
Yeah,
and recently, I have been watching a lot more movies. I actually am watching through the Harry Potter movies again right now.
Yeah, me too.
We're on the last two. And it's been really helpful to like actually sit down and watch
ironically
stuff.
Me too. So one of my favorite sequences out of all of that, and there is a little bit of a spoiler alert if you haven't seen it, but is when Dudley is making fun of Harry, and he's sitting on the swing set, and he says, "Where's your mom, Potter? Where's," like, that was the best British accent ever. Dude, just the subtle push in on him when he's just...
Are you talking about Draco?
No, dude, I'm talking about his cousin.
Oh, Dudley Dursley. Oh, yeah, yeah, never mind.
Yeah, dude. It might be like the fifth film, I think. And then it goes from that. It's this slow, subtle push in where he's saying it so softly, but it's like the worst thing that you can say to someone. And then it goes into this crazy handheld running high shutter speed chase scene. I was like, dude, this is next level, because that's the first film, in my opinion, where it really starts to get a little dark. You know, like you're like, oh, okay, this is going somewhere a lot deeper. So yeah, dude, I love that movie. All right, Adam, what about you? Number five.
My favorite Harry Potter is The Prisoner of Azkaban.
Yeah,
by the way,
that's a good one.
Mm-hmm. Directed by Alfonso Cuarón. I think that's how you pronounce it. I hope I said it right.
Yeah.
But he also did Gravity and Children of Men, which are two great movies, too. My number five, just to get it out of the way, is Jurassic Park.
Hey!
Adam's
Jurassic wearing Park. A Jurassic Park shirt.
Mm-hmm. Are you gonna
what is it
shirts?
About Jurassic? What is it specifically that you love about that movie?
Back in the day, it was definitely one of the ones that, like, I want to make movie magic. Like, watching that makes you, like,
so
they
made inspired you more
big
than
time.
Okay.
Yes, it's like that. That makes me want to make movies, because you can make dinosaurs come to life and nice. People believe it for 2 hours. You know that really did it for me. And then also it made me get into reading books. Like, I became a big Michael Crichton fan because of that, and the book Lost World, and I just ended up reading all his books and kind of falling in love with reading also through it. So.
Okay, mm-hmm. So we're obviously talking about the original Jurassic Park. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts on the newer variations, the newer versions? Jurassic World, I think is what it's called.
Yeah, I love Chris Pratt. I'm a big fan of him. I'm also a big fan of, there's several people in it, but they're good. I guess even the original is a popcorn movie. It's just the first one is just so special to me.
Because you didn't expect a lot of it. Yeah,
and now it's like they keep plussing it and plussing it. And that's good, but I do wish one person that happens to see this that has any control over that series, make it scary. It was scary. The first one to me, and I know it's because I was like 12 or 13 when I saw it or whatever it was, and it was scary. But like there's a great opportunity to get edgier with it. There's been 7 or 8 PG-13 Jurassic Parks now. Someone needs to come in and do like Logan, like they did with the X-Men, do a Logan, but with Jurassic Park.
Wow.
Like someone needs to do that.
Mm-hmm. All right, number four for me. And Adam, you'll absolutely be like, oh, of course. Jacob, you probably will say this too if you've seen it. Spinal Tap.
We said it at dinner that this is going to be on your list.
That's going to be on my list?
Yes. Lunch, yeah. We said Spinal Tap will be on his list.
Dude,
if it's not...
I freaking love that movie. I love The Office. I love Parks and Rec. I love the whole mockumentary. It's just brilliant. And for them to have done that so long ago, and it still holds up. The acting... It's fully, dude, if you didn't know any better, if you were just watching it, you would absolutely think that was just a documentary about this weird, crazy 80s, 70s, 80s rock band, hair band. And it's, I don't know, like there's, the cinematography is not amazing. It's just, it's full on documentary. But that, I think that's why I love it, because it feels so raw. And it feels so real. And a lot of it, what's funny is, what makes it funny is a lot of it is real. There really are people and bands that would tour and do these things and act this way, and they were completely oblivious to how they were being perceived by everyone else. They thought they were like killing it and crushing it. And I love one of the terms that one of the tour managers uses to try to make light of the situation that they're losing popularity. He says, I don't think that they're losing popularity. I just think that the audience is becoming more selective. Is that not some bull crap? I would say,
yeah,
to like weave my way out in a meeting or something. Yeah. Our client base is just becoming more selective. It's like, no, bro, you're losing clients. Like that's what's happening. Have you seen that movie?
I have not.
Jacob, 2 for 2 or 0 for 2. Oh, my gosh.
I did watch Best in Show about a month ago.
Yeah.
And that would be another good one to watch. It's about dog shows, but the same crew that made Spinal Tap, and they've made quite a few movies together.
Number four for Jacob.
Number four for Jacob is Hot Rod.
Dude.
No, I've not seen it.
Hot Rod is... It's like, what are you going to say?
Oh, no, no, no. I didn't mean it like that. I'm just saying, like, I have a second list down at the bottom of just, I would say, my favorite goofy comedies.
Yes.
It's Hot Rod and Waterboy, you know, those kind of movies.
Exactly.
It's on that little list. Yeah.
Out of all those, Hot Rod has always stuck with me more than anything. It, I think when I was thinking of this list, I was like, okay, I feel like personally, to make videos, I was inspired more and shaped more off of YouTube videos, like truthfully.
Ah, that's very important for listeners to hear.
Yeah.
That's very important because, and not to turn this into like pure business, but do you know that I think it was in 2020, there was a poll done and the top like career choice, I think it was around the globe, but I think it was in North America too. Number one from students that were interviewed, YouTuber for a career.
Like I grew up in the age where YouTube was like really kicking off. Dude. And there were a lot of like people that I followed like since it started, and that inspired me more. So that I kind of like transitioned that into Hot Rod, because Hot Rod is so goofy and it reminded me of some of those like just dumb like sketch comedy YouTube videos.
I have no idea what Hot Rod is. Never seen it.
It is some of the guys, it's like the guys that they were all on SNL together.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Andy Samberg
and
oh yeah, like
Kiva Schaefer, whatever his name is. Yeah.
Yeah.
Nick can fact check it for us right now.
Sure.
But that has just always showed me that like if you have an idea, it doesn't matter how goofy and stupid it is. If you make it and you do it right and you just own
it
and crush it.
We will make a podcast about that exact topic.
Yeah. Like
I completely agree. So, yeah, Andy Samberg.
Danny McBride.
Bill Hader's
Danny
in it.
Danny
McBride.
God, it's an incredible crew.
Isla Fisher is so funny.
Bill Hader
Will
is
Arnett's
one of the most talented
Will
Arnett, fellows
Chris
around
Parnell.
In the acting world.
Yeah, dude, those are that's a good lineup.
It is so funny.
Adam,
number
four.
You absolutely have to watch it.
I will watch it.
And I will say about Hot Rod, that like what made me the biggest fan, like I'm laughing all the way through it, but that fall. Like the fall down the cliff is like what made me love that movie. Oh my gosh. Which you'll see.
You need to watch it. You need to watch it.
I'm just looking at them like
it's like a Monty Python kind of thing.
Oh,
like
cool. Okay.
Yeah. I've seen it probably like 100 times.
Nice.
Like, it's so good.
Adam's number four. We're waiting patiently.
Number four. Number four, Forrest Gump.
Oh, dude, absolutely.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Never seen. I'm just kidding.
And it's.
I wouldn't doubt it. You just saw Titanic last night for the first time,
and it was so good.
It's so good.
Watch That's Titanic.
That should be an honorable mention. But yeah, Forrest Gump. What is it about Forrest Gump that you love so much?
A lot of things. I mean, number one, you just love him. Like, that's what makes it so special, is you do just love him. He's such a good character, and it's like, if there are more people like him in the world, it'd be a better place. And you want to watch him for a couple hours and see what he does. But also, just they cover so much history through it, and it's all improbable, of course, but it's just like seeing this cool character go through all these historical events is like, just, it's a fun journey, I would say.
You know what I would say too is what? All of us are, in a way, could be that character, because all of us have gone through historical events in our own way, just like he did. It's just that we don't have a movie made about us. Not yet.
That's right.
Not yet. But like that, and so that is cool, because even though Forrest has his obvious struggles, like, you people can see themselves in Forrest in different ways. And obviously all of us can, because we're from Alabama. Alabama.
He played for Crimson Tide.
Oh, yeah, Crimson Tide.
Yeah, literally, he runs right across the field.
It's literally right down the road from us. Yeah, are we one or two streets down from Bryant Drive?
Yeah.
One or two.
Not far.
That's Bear Bryant.
We're within a mile of the stadium or so, I would say.
All right, number three, Conan the Barbarian. And I doubt that Jacob has seen this.
0-3.
I was just talking to Abby about this the other day.
I made Adam watch it.
I was surprised. It's so funny. And it, I mean, it's
Conan
good.
The Barbarian?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, there are some funny
parts
in it.
Here's what's good about it.
Yeah. I was like,
No.
Do you mean bloody? Because I could see that. There are comedic parts in it that you don't expect, though.
It's like, because he hasn't seen it, and I don't want to spoil it for anyone, but he punches something that is so
funny.
Oh, okay,
we can just tell him. Arnold Schwarzenegger. Yeah, so, okay, with that,
there are awesome funny
parts that you do not expect, because it's not a comedy. It's very serious. It's like there's blood everywhere. But there's a part where Conan, that's Arnold Schwarzenegger, gets drunk and fully punches a camel and knocks it out, and he really did it.
Oh, my God. He just hauls off and punches a camel and knocks the camel out.
Like,
which is terrible, but it's
terrible,
so funny
but
in
it's
the
pretty
film.
Funny.
I mean, to believe it's not real, but, you know.
Yeah, like...
probably was real.
Unfortunately, that type of stuff is humorous. If you've ever seen Jackass, if you've ever watched It Ridiculousness, stuff like that, it just happens. Oh, then he does it. That's Conan the Destroyer. So he punches a horse in that one. That's the second movie, which is great.
Yeah.
And that's also the second movie right there. But Conan the Barbarian is the one that I'm talking about. So yeah, that's Destroyer. Nick has got some clips going.
Did they have to put the animals were harmed in the making of this film?
Yeah.
In the
credits? Something else interesting about that movie. There's a shot where he has a buzzard is trying to eat him as he's dying. And he bites the buzzard's neck and kills the buzzard. That was not real, but the buzzard was real. It was a real dead buzzard that they put in Arnold Schwarzenegger's mouth. And he's biting all over it and lets it drop to the ground dead.
Wow.
And then they just gave him, I think, Jack Daniels and something else to rinse it, wash his mouth out. Immediately after. Dude, that movie's crazy how they made it. And it's just, I don't know. So here's the deal. I watched that movie when I was really little. I think it came out when I was born, but my dad loved that movie. And so I would run around in Asheville, Alabama, in my whitey tidy underwear when I was five, and my dad would make me these wooden swords, and I would run around and I would act like Conan the Barbarian, shove the sword through my underwear, walking around outside, because that's how Conan is kind of dressed, and I would fight with my brother with these swords. And so that, I don't know, that movie's just always been a part of my life. Is it the best movie in the world? No, but it's really, really good, and it's just something that I'll always say, that's in my top five, just because it kind of shaped me a little bit in just being a movie lover. All right, number three, Jacob.
Shutter Island.
Dude, I haven't seen that.
Oh,
what? What is wrong with us?
Wow.
I think I know
I'm
what it is. It's the fact
it.
That I'm yeah. 35 and you're
that's a Marty Scorsese
24?
26, but I'll take 24.
Okay, 26.
Works.
Yeah, the age gap here. must obviously is going into play. That's okay though. Okay, if Leonardo DiCaprio's in it, then I'll automatically.
Yeah, it's a Scorsese movie.
This is my first introduction. Like when I watched this, this was my first introduction into the psychological thriller realm, and that is without a doubt my favorite like movie genre. So like you watch, I love movies where you watch the whole thing and you're thinking something and then you are completely misled the entire way.
Isn't there another movie where he's on an island as well? I feel like there is. Is this the movie where like a guy gets like gangrene and almost dies and they're like in a tent?
No.
That's a totally different movie. It's also Leonardo DiCaprio though. Okay, never mind.
I remember.
It's some kind of island movie. I don't remember.
I don't know.
Speaking of Leo, you just saw Titanic. The Beach. Mm-hmm. There it is. I knew it. Yeah, that's a good movie too. But
I have not seen that one.
Yeah.
I need to see that.
I saw part of it. I haven't seen the whole
part of it.
All right, Adam, number three.
Number three, The Breakfast Club.
Bro, so good.
Mm-hmm.
So good.
Yeah.
Tell me you've seen it.
I've seen it. Yay. I just have opinions.
Well, I would say, okay, there's a couple things about The Breakfast Club. Couple things. I grew to like it more as I got older. I homeschooled in high school. So seeing this, I'm coming from a different angle to where I didn't have like the proper like high school experience. So like seeing them and all the different, like there's the jock, all the different people and how they, like normally they would just be in their own little worlds, but they're put together in detention and you see the interactions and all that. And I love that about it. And it's super funny, but there is some things about it that I could say.
Obviously, Jacob just hates this movie.
I don't hate the movie. I think what happened is when I finally watched it, so many people have been like, oh my God, this is one of the best movies ever. You have to watch it, this and this and this. And then I watched it and I was just like, I mean, it was good. It was a good movie. It just got overhyped for me before I watched it.
Do you know why it was overhyped? Because people love nostalgia.
Yes.
And the people that were probably telling you it was amazing are people that watched that movie when it was in its prime.
And that's what I was going to say. Is like I could see it being like that pinnacle, like coming of age kind of late high school movie for a lot of people during that time frame when it came out.
This is why the show... what's the show about the 80s with all Stranger Things. This is why Stranger Things is so...
Scary Things.
Scary Things, same thing.
The Downside Up.
Yeah, like, the Downside
Watch
Up.
On Netflix.
This is, in my opinion, why Stranger Things is so successful. It's a great show, but I think it leans heavily into nostalgia, and that people love it for the nostalgia as much as they do the story itself. People wish that malls were still a thing and that there were no ways to text and communicate and you had to use these big, you know, walkie talkies and, you know, so that I think Stranger Things, and I think there's no, they don't like try to cover that up either. They're like, yeah, we absolutely lean heavily into nostalgia on purpose because people love it and that's totally fine. Yeah, I like The Breakfast Club too, man. That's a good movie.
I don't dislike it.
I saw it in my 20s, so I didn't see it back in the day, but I liked it when I first saw it, but I didn't love it. And it's just something like I ended up seeing it again and liking it more. And then, you know, over time, I liked it more and more. But I will say that Molly Ringwald has a different opinion now on the movie than back in the day. She said, I watched it with my little girl. And she's like, I hadn't seen it since I was little, you know, or since back then. And she's like, watching it with my daughter was an interesting experience because there's some things in there. And I won't say, but there's some things in there that she's like, I was like, why did we do that? Because it is, there's some bad stuff, but you know, anyway,
sure.
It's just, it was a different time in the 80s.
Number two for me, which was, some people were like, how is that not your number one? But number two for me is Inception. What do you think about Inception, Jacob?
I didn't love Inception either.
Dude, what? Inception is incredible.
I've been wanting to go back and watch it again, but
you have to watch it again.
I think, like, I watched Shutter Island and I almost put those in like the same kind of things. Like I saw that before I saw Inception and to me, for some reason, there was something so, I don't know, I think it's maybe just like the darkness of it. I like really dark movies for some reason, and then I went and watched Inception and it was all hyped up and I was like, oh, this is gonna be awesome. And then I watched it and I was like, hey, it was good.
Yeah, you gotta watch it again.
Yeah,
it's great. I mean, and so in my, so I really kind of have a tie for number two and a tie for number one, but Inception and Interstellar are both like neck and neck for me. And the problem I have with Interstellar is that I can't watch it without bawling my freaking eyes out. Because I'm a dad, and I have two boys and two daughters, and dude, watching that movie freaking wrecks me.
The scene where he gets that, like the
dude, the, yeah, don't spoil anything, but like
that moment is those, hard to
and
watch.
The ending wrecks me. Even though Nick disagrees, he's like, the ending's happy, and I was like, it's bittersweet. It's not
bittersweet.
Like,
that's a good way to describe it.
Yeah, but dude, so Inception though, I think is just phenomenal, because if you haven't seen Inception, hopefully I don't give any spoilers, but at the end, in my opinion, Leonardo DiCaprio, he's in several of these top fives. Basically he doesn't care what the true outcome is. All he cares is that he's, you know, in the place that he wanted to be, and that to me speaks volumes. Because again, it doesn't matter. It's like it doesn't matter anymore. You know what I mean?
I've never thought about it like that.
That's a beautiful thing, in a way. It's also a terrible thing in a way, because it's like, well, you're not facing reality, but ignorance is bliss, and that's true. And so it's like, either way, I'm where I wanted to be. So, you see what I'm saying? I don't think that I spoiled anything, and if I did, I do truly apologize. But yeah.
I'm kind of curious, and I almost want to send Kevin out of the room for this, what y'all's opinion is of which I can't phrase the question without Gavin leaving the room, but what you think the actual thing that happened was.
Oh, like the ending?
We can say, like, he won't understand what this means. We could say, is it real or is it not real?
Yeah, that's fine. But spoiler alert.
Yeah, spoiler alert. But, like, he's not going to have any clue what that
okay,
we're
fine.
Talking
so
about.
So what do y'all think?
I think it's real.
I think it's real, too.
I choose to believe it's real.
I think it's fake.
It's all for right, the sake Nick, of the you're character. You're not in this podcast. No, I'm just kidding. All right, number two for Jacob.
Perfect segue. Interstellar.
Hey, yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah,
dude, that mine was tied. Like, yeah. Yeah. Is it about Interstellar?
So is Interstellar your one?
No. Okay, I'm saying Interstellar, like... Interstellar, and Interception and Inception are tied for number two. Mm-hmm. Not Interception.
That's Matthew McConaughey catches a football. What about it?
Yeah.
It just blew my mind more than any movie I'd ever seen. And what's crazy, it's not even that old. Yeah. Like, I'd seen a lot of amazing movies. I'd seen, like, all the Star Wars movies. I'd seen, like, anything and everything with, like, heavy special effects and whatnot. And just the storyline was so powerful and the acting was so good. And there was so much emotion. And I cried and I laughed. And I was just like, wow.
Yeah.
Like, and then just trying to interpret what it even means.
Sure.
Is, yeah. Like, it made me think more. Like, I like leaving a movie and just being like, I have to think about it.
Yeah.
Like, a lot. Like, I've been thinking about Titanic for, like, 3 days now. I'm just like, God, that would be so horrible. Yeah.
Like, that really happened.
Like,
awful.
Imagine meeting somebody like that and just ripped away like that.
Sure. So. Yeah. No, that's Titanic's in a great film.
Yeah.
Number two for Adam.
Number two is The Princess Bride.
Dude, that is so, like, I struggled. That I would say that's definitely an honorable mention. But something funny about The Princess Bride is you notice in Spinal Tap that actor, he says, Christopher Guest, this goes to 11. And Christopher Guest in The Princess Bride has 11 fingers.
Yeah, that's, yeah.
I don't know. I just thought that was funny.
Well, yeah.
All right. So what is it? Have you seen The Princess Bride?
No.
Dude, just
dude,
go away.
That one. Oh, my God. Okay.
That's one of those where I feel like I've seen parts of it.
They, like, played it on TV so much through the years. You've probably seen pieces,
like,
of it.
I probably recognize a lot of parts of it, but I don't think I've ever sat down and watched it all the way through.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a really good action adventure, but at its core, I think it's a comedy. But it comes back. Like, it'll be comedic for a while, but you still care enough about the adventure at the middle of it that it keeps you going. You know, I read the book and really loved it, and but I've just always loved it. I grew up watching it, and I can watch it anytime. If anyone hasn't seen it, I'm like, well, let's watch it right now.
Okay, let's watch it right now.
All right.
Pull it up on the
let's do a podcast there. Watching Princess Bride.
Dude, it's awesome. Mm-hmm. Like, it's funny. It's serious. It's got everything. Just like the little fella at the beginning of the movie says, the grandpa. Like, it's got everything.
Hey, yeah. Who's the sickie?
Dude, yeah. Princess Bride is amazing. My mom loved that movie, so we would watch it all the time, too. So, yeah, that's a good one. I grew up with that one. All right, the moment of truth, number one for me. And the problem is it's another tie. but I'm going to give you the first one that I wrote down. And anyone that knows me will say, that makes complete sense. Dumb and Dumber.
Oh, okay. Okay. Oh, my God.
That's not what I expected it to be.
But does it make sense?
Yeah, it makes sense. That's like your comedy.
Dude.
To a T.
It makes me laugh.
You said you haven't seen Hot Rod?
I have not seen Hot Rod.
Oh, yeah.
You need to watch Hot Rod.
They're in kind of the same category.
Dude, Dumb and Dumber, just, it makes me smile. And the thing is it's not that dirty. There's, like, only a few things where, like, I can watch that movie with my kids. There's only a couple scenes. There's only a couple words that I'm, like, earmuffs or cover your eyes, or I just skip literally, like, one part of a scene and it's over. Like, I don't know. I just, it's funny. I freaking love Jim Carrey. And the story draws you in, believe it or not. Like, there is a real story that's being told there. And you don't even notice it or realize that it's, like, happening, because you just get completely enveloped and engulfed in the movie. You're laughing. You don't cry in that movie. But then I was thinking about it, and I was like, dude, I can't let Dumb and Dumber be, like, define me as, like, that's my number one.
Yeah, sure you can.
So, well, I but it is the first one I thought of when I was, like, being really honest with myself. What's a movie I could watch or have watched over and over and over and still enjoy it? And that's Dumb and Dumber.
Mm-hmm.
The other one that's tied is The Truman Show. And that is also Jim Carrey. And it's amazing. And it's a little more serious, but there are some funny moments in it.
It's a Ron Howard film.
Yeah, but in that film, I think Jim Carrey showed the world, like, is that a Ron Howard film?
Yeah, like, random fact.
It's a Ron Howard film.
It's a Ron Howard film, which he's done tons of amazing movies.
Yeah, it was. Okay. Yeah. So in that, like, to me, Jim Carrey, like, showed the world that he's way more of a capable actor in The Truman Show, that he had not, like, really been able to prove himself. And that was a defining film. Another defining film was Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, which I freaking love. That's an honorable mention. But yeah, those are probably my top, like, two, is Dumb and Dumber and The Truman Show. I can't get enough. I'll watch them over and over and over, and I'll just, that's it. That's who I am. What do you think about The Truman Show?
I haven't seen it. That's one that I've had on my list to watch for a very long time, and I just haven't got around to it.
That's one of those, like, Whiplash.
I just watched Titanic the other
Jacob,
day. Like,
you have to watch Whiplash, and you finally do, and now you love it.
Yeah, Whiplash is amazing.
All right, what's your number one?
My number one is The Prestige.
Wow. Dude, I haven't seen it.
That's a great one. Yeah.
With the times, George.
Dude, we gotta
that's
we gotta have a
Nolan
movie
next. He's like, I know.
Nick, is that your favorite Nick?
Of the Christopher Nolan's?
Oh, yeah.
No, I mean, Christopher Nolan's my favorite person ever, but yeah.
I agree.
What's your favorite? Prestige is awesome. Probably Tenet.
Tenet.
Yeah.
You're speaking to two owners.
You're just going to have to talk about Prestige then, because I've not seen it.
We both own Tenet and have not seen it.
And it is hard to talk too much about The Prestige because so many things happen in it.
Yeah.
Because one thing leads... So you can set it up and talk about what it is, but a lot of cool things happen that...
Can I give you, like, what it's about?
Yeah, what's it about?
It's about, like, two really passionate dueling magicians in, like, the 1920s or something.
Yeah, so, like, that's all I know, though.
Yeah, it's, like, early 1900s, like, there's some, like, randomly, like, Nikola Tesla makes an appearance. There's all kinds of, like, crazy stuff that happens.
David Bowie plays.
Yeah, it's...
Nice.
It's really good.
Labyrinth is my favorite movie. I'm just kidding. That's a great movie.
I almost put on my honorable mentions.
All right. So, number one from Adam Honeycutt.
It's been my favorite movie for decades, probably, but it's called Awakenings.
Neither one of us have seen
probably
that.
Probably not.
I can
not
tell
many
by
people
Jacob's
have.
Reaction.
I was just like, what? What is that?
It is I guess you'd call it a medical drama, but the setup is, and it's Robin Williams.
Oh, dude, of course I'm going to love it if he's in it.
And it's he's a very quiet, serious doctor.
Okay.
And I grew up watching that with him, and that made me appreciate him from the time I was little, because everyone knows Robin Williams is like Mork and Mindy and all these crazy, like, crazy Flubber and all this kind of stuff. But all these great movies like Flubber. He really is amazing. It's one of the best performances he ever did. Mm. Robert De Niro, one of the best he did. which is hard to say because, okay, so basically the story is you, there are a lot of patients that are basically frozen and they don't know why. Like, they'll just sit there and they won't move. And so it's kind of a medical mystery, and Robin Williams takes it upon himself to try to figure out why these people are frozen. So that's kind of the setup. And he's an outcast. No one believes in him or likes him. And it's just that journey. It's really good. A Penny Marshall film, which she did A League of Their Own. And she's a great director. So
he also had a movie where he plays a doctor, and but I think the front of the cover of the movie, he's got like these big red shoes on. What was that movie? Robin Williams.
Where as a doctor?
Yeah, dude. And
Patch Adams.
Is that what it is? And he does like a free clinic mm-hmm. kind of deal.
Yeah, dude,
that
true story. So good, dude. Based
that,
on a
and
true
I thought
story.
That was mm-hmm. a true story. Yeah.
Yeah, he did great in that too.
Sweet. Well, this was fun. So Adam has a secret that he hasn't explained or told us. Why? So you're a little deeper in the movie world than Jacob and I are. Tell us about how you were a... I'm going to let you say it.
Well, once upon a time, I used to write reviews on Amazon. And it became one of the top... I think at the time there was probably 200 or 300 million people on Amazon at that time, which was probably 1 billion now. And I was in the top 4,000.
Yeah, that's
which
insane.
Is not bad.
That's insane.
I guess. But
as like a movie reviewer.
Yeah, and I wrote about 130 reviews just very selectively and just worked up through the ranks. Like, you start out at like 200 million and then you get to finally 1 million and keep working. And
yeah.
Yeah. Became a top like 4,300, I think. And then
you just had a conflict and
I did,
just deleted
and, it. And I actually met some actual, like, I mean, celebrities, and they were talking to me and they're like, that's what you call on the wrong side of the fence. Like, if you're a filmmaker, like if you're being a critic, you know, and then actual filmmaking, and they were kind of upset about it that I even mentioned it. They're like, we don't even like critics kind of thing.
Wow.
And
yeah.
I'm like, oh, okay, well, if I want to be a serious filmmaker, then I should probably focus on actual filmmaking and not just acting like I know.
Trying to rip people apart. Wow.
Yeah. So I let it go and just started focusing on actually learning how to write scripts and story form and all this kind of stuff. And
so that then some other critic somewhere can just rip
to
your
rip
crap
me
apart.
Apart and I'll get to eat it all right there.
Such yeah. is the
Which
life.
They have some of the I things bet. I worked on, yeah.
Yeah, so you've worked on some feature films, mm-hmm. and have you ever worked on a feature film?
Mm-mm.
No, neither have I. Mm-hmm. And people that are listening to this, like, we've got friends in LA and Hollywood, and they're like, that's like the industry there, but over here in Alabama, like that doesn't happen often. You go to Atlanta, you can do some features, but yeah, we're more Jacob and I right now are more like corporate or documentary, so. Yeah, that's pretty cool, though. Well, this was fun, fellers.
Yeah, this was fun.
Yeah, thank you for being part of it. Is there anything else you wanted to add before we let you go?
I will say, the list is impossible. Like, it's hard to pick 5 or 10 favorites. I mean, it'd be easy to put a couple hundred down. It's just you love movies kind of thing. So that was tough. But a lot of movies left on the cutting floor.
So if you're on YouTube or on one of the podcast platforms, drop a comment below. Let us know your top favorite 5 movies.
Rip Adam to shreds.
Yeah. Rip Adam to shreds. Tell him his movies are terrible.
Yes.
Especially the Alabama in the Making documentary.
Yes. Emmy award-winning documentary.
The only one that we've done that's any sort of a feature-length anything at Seed Creative.
We're one for one.
Yeah, we're going to just talk about that nonstop. That's all we're ever going to talk about. Hey, y'all, by the way, we did a documentary, so...
Yeah, let's talk about Alabama
in
the Making.
2021, we won an Emmy.
You remember? Oh, man. With that, I will we'll see y'all on the next one. Be sure to subscribe, like, comment, or don't. I don't really... No, I do care, actually. I care a lot.
We need your validation.
Yeah, we need your validation. Feed me your likes and comments.
Smash the like button.
Yes, just cut. Just cut right there.
Ding that bell.
This podcast was produced by Nick Golden with executive producer George Edmondson, edited by Nick Golden and Gavin Manning. Be sure to subscribe, drop a like and a comment. Tune in every Monday for brand new podcast content, and we'll see you on the next one.